What's up, Tribe? It is Thursday morning, and we are here to talk about good coaching versus bad coaching today. We're going to go off on a little bit of a different direction. We're also answering some really good questions that have come in from our tribe here at the gym and the Movement Mastermind, Anthony Ogilvy. We're going to be talking a little bit about your question, and we'll also answer a couple of great questions that have come in over the last 24 hours. All that and more coming up right after this. We are the gym that teaches people how to move instead of just exercise, because we believe that health is about performance, not just body image. Welcome. In case we haven't met, my name is Yanni Bormeister, and to my right is my brother Rad Bormeister. Behind the camera producing the show is Richard Lely, so if anything goes wrong, you can blame him. Today we've got a really interesting topic. It's a question that's come through from our YouTube channel. But first, as always, we want to welcome, we went live with our flash sale on Tuesday this week, and we've got a whole heap of new people who've come in and joined the tribe. Welcome to all of you new guys. I cannot wait to see you progress over the next 6 weeks and beyond. Hopefully we do what we've promised and kill you with love so that you stay on forever. But yeah, welcome. Make yourselves known in the Movement Mastermind Facebook group. Once you get access, introduce yourself. We really, really can't wait to meet you. First up, I think you should answer Anthony's question from our gym tribe here.
Sure. So Anthony has asked, morning Rad. Fair point regarding using the group to ask questions. Well, I want to say that. And I want to say this.
That's fair enough.
He said, fair point regarding using the group to ask questions. And the reason why he said that is because he emailed me personally. And to be honest, I don't like getting emails personally or getting personal messages. Unless it's a very personal matter that you don't want other people in the group, then of course email us directly. But we want people, the whole idea is about having a tribe, is that everybody benefits from it. And the awesome thing about this is, Anthony, you can see Blakely has already chimed in and given you some his feedback, which is the power of this group.
Yeah,
you
know, people are
the herd mentality. Everybody's going to get in and give their 2 cents, and you're going to get a really rounded answer. But
just very quickly on this, guys. I do this all the time and interrupt. Make no mistake, the power of humanity is in the tribe. And this is how we evolved to the top of the food chain. We are not very strong on our own. We are powerful in a tribe, and that's what we're trying to do here. So continue.
Yeah. So anyway, Anthony's question is, what do you do with your head during the front body line? Slightly elevated, resting on forehead or resting on the chin? I ask because I use my chin / nose, but my jaw is getting sore-ish. I'm working on relaxing it during the move, but still thought it's worth asking. So the front body line is a movement that we use to develop a handstand. So for those of you that are following the IFMS program, you know what it is. And in the front body line, Anthony, you should have your nose resting on the ground, which means that the muscles in your neck are active. You're not just plonking your head on the ground. But the nose resting on the ground make sure that you don't pull your head back too much. It keeps your head in alignment with the spine. Now, a sore jaw, I'll be honest, I've never heard of that one before. If your jaw is getting sore, maybe...
I'll add something to this, because I have looked into this a lot. If the muscles that control the mandible are getting sore, it's both a good thing and a bad thing. A good thing is that when you activate your core musculature, it's a system in the body that braces and protects the entire spine. And that means that the sternocleidomastoids, the neck muscles, all of this works in synergy with the core muscles. If you're over stimulating the jaw here, it may just be that there's a little bit of an imbalance. And I'd be interested to know whether, I'll talk to you actually straight up here, Anthony. I'd be interested to talk to you more. Luckily, you are going to be in the gym today and we can have a chat, if this is something that you've experienced in other exercises too, because it may just be signaling that there is too much happening in the, I can't remember the muscles that control the mandible here, the bone in the jaw, but there is a lot of them. So we probably need to take it offline and talk, get a little bit more specific with your issue. But in general, if you feel the muscles in your neck and things activating, then absolutely, that's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. And it may just be, it may be as simple as it exposing a weak point in your body. It may be exposing an overuse area of your body. And that's why I'd like to investigate whether you've had this before with any sort of other movement practice or anything else that you do. But the neck and all of that sort of stuff, we are trying to train. And it's super important that you do so. Because if you don't, you end up with a weak link in the kinetic chain, and that's not a good thing. Rad can probably elaborate on that more.
Yeah, look, it's you feel, people always say when they're doing an exercise to us, they always say, oh man, I'm feeling it here, or I'm feeling it here, should I be doing it? Well, you're going to feel it where you need it. You're going to feel the exercise wherever you're the weakest. You know, sometimes people are doing exercise incorrectly, and you need to you do need to focus on fixing up the technique. But more often than not, the way that I like to describe it is pay attention to the instruction. So, you know, the cue in this case is, you know, keep your nose touching the ground. That's really the only cue. I don't say lift your head up or tuck your chin in. I just say keep the nose touching the ground, and you'll be all right. If you feel that in your neck, if you feel that in your jaw, then those are muscles, and you're keeping that relaxed as best as you can, then those muscles are probably a weak link in the chain, and you need to work on that. You need to just keep going with it and keep strengthening with it. If it turns from feeling it in the jaw or feeling it in the neck to I've got pain in my jaw, like,
well, I think that's what he's alluded to, that he's getting pain in his jaw.
I mean,
in the email that I read, and I could be wrong, Anthony, but I think it was that you were getting a bit of pain in the jaw. And you could try and do circular breathing, so in through the nose, out through the mouth, and that might help relax the muscles in the jaw.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we'll talk to you more about it in the gym and see.
And I remember when I started doing Kung Fu 20 years ago, and we used to do abdominal exercises, I used to get such bad pain in the back of my neck that at times during training, I had to completely stop. I was in so much pain. And I also used to, when I used to do the horse stance, I used to feel it in my knees really, really badly. I'd get really sore on the outside of the knee. And when I asked my Kung Fu teacher, he didn't have an ounce of the knowledge of anatomy and physiology that I now have myself. But his answer was always, he said, yeah, Rad, your body will adjust. You know, you're going to experience pain in your body as you become stronger, and then it will adjust. And that's exactly what happened. Mm. I don't like using the word push through, because I don't want people to think that we're saying push through pain, and when you're feeling pain, just keep going to the other side. But when I say push through, I mean is trust the process. Like, stop when you feel the pain and take a break. But the process of getting stronger is uncomfortable.
And it's different for everybody. It's a process of self.
Yeah, everyone's different.
You know, there is a massive element of stepping outside your comfort zone. I went through the same thing with boxing. First, it was the hands and wrists had to condition, and then I had to condition my ankles and calves because we did so much skipping and running, and I got really bad shin splints from that. And there was just elements of it. My neck as well. I had to do a period of about a year where I did so many neck crunching, like weighted neck movements to build strength in my neck.
When you find
intense.
That, when you like, one of the strengths of the foundation movement system is that we identify weak links in the kinetic chain. And when you identify that you've got a weak link, you need to go above and beyond to turn that into a strong link.
Yeah.
And more often than not, it requires a ridiculous amount of work for what you would have thought it would require. But in my experience, most weak links can be corrected in 6 months.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you agree? Like, if you do the right amount of work,
12 weeks.
Most of the time.
12 weeks if you focus on it.
I'm saying 6 months maximum.
Yeah.
Yeah. Between 12 and 24 weeks, so 3 to 6 months, 95% of weak links can be corrected if you do the right amount of work.
Yeah. Quick shout out, we've got someone on the live chat, Pharaoh. Welcome back, mate. It's great to see you again. Let's move on.
And let's, because we've only got about 12 or 13 minutes left, let's not waffle a lot. Let's get into it and just give your intro and then we'll...
Yep. So the question, can you just jump over to our questions, or Richard over there? you gotta go to. Oh, you can do that. No, you're better off, yeah, going to the actual page.
I mean, YouTube data or whatever. We don't need to read the whole question.
Yeah, we do, because I want to know. I want to answer it properly. Should be right there, mate. It's
All right. What am I doing here?
Got it. Where are you? Are you logged in?
Look, yeah, I'm logged in, man.
Yeah. Okay. So go here.
You know, all of them are there. Right?
Oh, I see. Okay.
You just scooty. Who was it by? Yeah,
that guy. That's the question there.
There you go.
All right. Okay.
So, all right. So, Boba San says, "Hey, greetings from Romania. Thanks for answering my question. Really helpful information. If you don't mind, I've got another one. I was wondering if you could talk about how to be a great coach. You've talked before about the actual programming and exercise selection and prioritizing mobility and stability, but I'm also curious about what other insights you have on dealing with different kinds of people, obese people, injured people, depressed people, etc. Also, what attitude should I have as I work towards being a really good coach?"
This is a great question, and it's a big open-ended question, so we've got to be careful not to go down a rabbit hole. So all we can do is speak from experience. Rad and I have been coaching people for over 16 years now, Rad for longer than that because he was a Kung Fu instructor before that for about 10 years.
13 years.
Yeah. And at the New South Wales Wushu Academy, which was quite a big martial arts academy, probably nothing in comparison to what you guys have in America where, you know, I've seen the movies, Karate Kid and stuff like that. But anyway, now, the biggest thing, and I'll say this very specifically because I'm a strong believer of this. I've got a strong opinion. The biggest thing about becoming a really good coach and the difference between a mediocre and a great coach is specialization or niching. Like finding what you're really passionate about so that you'll continue to love it even when time gets tough. And niching down on that. So you've said there, you know, how do I deal with different people in the most professional manner, obese people, injured people? I would say don't. I would say choose who you love to coach the most. Because as long as you love going to work every day, and this was a big thing, this comes from a really tough series of lessons for us. I started out as a injury specialist because I had a broken spine as a young child, and I had a series of bad injuries, which just sort of pushed me into that arena. Then we became weight loss coaches because we thought that was a good financial decision to make because so many people needed help, and we thought we'd have an endless supply of clients, and it did, but it wasn't what we were passionate about. We've never been overweight, and we just weren't as passionate about that. We're passionate about movement, and we're passionate about teaching people how to move and nourish their bodies. And it took 10 years, really, realistically, maybe 13 years to finally make the decision that we were just gonna follow our passion and really niche down. And now I'll be honest, my man, we turn people away that aren't the right fit for our program because we're not the best weight loss coaches. You know, you would be better off going to a specific weight loss clinic if your primary, like key goal coming to Unity Gym was weight loss, because we're not the best weight loss coaches, and it would be doing that person a disservice to try and hold on to them just to add them to our client book, you know. And so that would be my biggest lesson and my biggest piece of wisdom that I can impart on you. And that you can't do that, like it takes years. It does take a long time to find your true passion and your true calling. And you can't really rush that. So try a little bit of everything. But once you find something that you're truly passionate about, 10x your knowledge on that area. Like just go all in and read and learn and study and train under the right people like we have, and then embrace the journey and just niche down more and more and more on what you're passionate about, because you can't be the best at everything. And if you try to be, I know this is so cliche, you'll be a master of nothing. So have you got anything to add?
That's pretty much it. I mean, you have to just accept. Like, I remember when I was a juvenile coach or personal trainer, whatever you want to call it, the I just couldn't, I didn't understand how I was ever going to be good. When I looked at the guys that were good and that knew more than me and that could do more than me, I got so intimidated by it that I almost just sort of turned a blind eye to it. I just kind of like didn't want to look at the idea of what I had to do. But I was so determined with what it is that I was doing, and we just stuck it out and, you know, pushed through. And I think focusing on your own personal development, like Yanni said, is one of the most important things by a long shot. You have to be, I think passionate is like down here. You have to be obsessed with what you do if you want to be a good coach. It's got to be something that, like the way that I define an obsession is, people say to me, people say things like, oh, I can't do that, or I don't have the time to do that, or I just have never been able to achieve that. And I say the only reason why you've never been able to do that is because you're not obsessed with it. And people say to me, oh yeah, yeah, I'm obsessed. Like people say, I've got friends that want to lose weight, and they say, no, I'm obsessed with losing weight. I hate being overweight. And I say, no, you're not obsessed about it. You're passionate about it, because if you're obsessed about it, there's nothing that can stop you if you're obsessed. Like, the only thing I believe, honestly, in my heart, that can stop an obsessed person is being put in prison. It's the only thing that can stop you when you're obsessed.
I don't even think that would stop you.
Yeah.
Because you see people still conquer all odds and get uni degrees and transform their bodies and come out of prison a completely changed person.
Yeah, you're right.
I think death is the only thing that can stop
you. Yeah. And that's the thing. Like, people say, oh, but I don't know where to start. That's not my problem. It's not Yanni's problem, and it's not anybody else's problem. It's your problem. If you don't know where to start, figure out where to start. And I'll tell you right now, if you're on this show, I'll tell you where to start. Start with our program if you want to know how to become a good coach, because that's what I did. What I did was, and what Yanni did was, all we did was we looked around us, who's better than us that we can learn from. And man, we learned everything that we could from that person until a better coach presented themselves. So if we're not the best coach that's presented themselves to you, then go to the better coach.
Yeah, and the financial commitment has been incredible. Like, I've paid some years $70,000, upwards of $80,000 on coaching, on being mentored by people better than me. We've run a business that made a lot of money, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars, and we've only paid ourselves $50,000-$60,000 so that we could reinvest that money.
Which, by the way, in America, that's like the equivalent of paying yourselves about $25,000.
$25,000 or $30,000. Yeah, like literally, we've lived just above what the category of being. What do you call it when you're ridiculously poor?
Poverty.
We've paid ourselves just enough to stay above the poverty line.
Stay in the lower middle
class. Lower end of the income bracket, because we wanted to reinvest in our education. And you know, I often have to get told, I run the finances here and I spend way too much on books. Because we realized that we just needed to double down on what we do, you know. Now, as far as the psychology component goes, I think there's a psychological element to every coaching, whether you're an athlete's coach, like you're training professional athletes, whether you're training overweight people, whether you're training general populations who want to learn to move and nourish their bodies. There's always going to be a psychological element. So I think that's a really great area to double down on, irrespective. You need to understand how to convince people of your or build people's courage up around the principles that you're teaching them. And that's, I've been gifted with the fact that I've suffered depression most of my life, which forced me to have to learn about psychology. Otherwise, I would have lost my battle with depression a long time ago, meaning resorted to suicide or something like that. My way of overcoming my depression was through exercise and through learning about psychology, learning about and understanding the chemical reactions that are occurring throughout my body, and learning how to disassociate from the emotions that they trigger. And I look at that as a gift. That's been a real blessing in disguise for me. And, you know, Rad and I both suffered quite severe injuries in our spine. And that is a gift too, because we had to overcome it. It was either that or a life of being excessively overweight and unhealthy, you know. Mm. So all of these things. Here's a tip, Bobobo, or Bobosin, I've stuffed up your name. It's your handle, I'm sure, on your YouTube channel. Your ideal client will most likely be just like you, only a few years behind on their journey. And honestly, that's the best way I could frame it. We learned that recently from an expert, and it's really true, right? Since we made that switch to focusing on people who were just like us, it's not narcissistic, it's not vanity. It's just that they're the people that you're going to communicate best with, and they're the people that you're going to most easily attract into your tribe, and they're the people that you're going to enjoy the most hanging out with as well. You know, so. That's, I think, really key. I think you should start there and then define who that person is, define how you're going to help them, and then get busy learning the best strategies to do so.
Yeah, absolutely. It's and when you do that, everything in your world starts to change. And the hardest, it's hard to make the leap. It's hard to make the leap at the start because you feel like, you know, you will not get as many new clients straight away when you start. You know, if you're really honest with someone, when someone comes to you, I mean, there was someone here only just yesterday that walked in the door and asked about the gym, and I said to him, what are his goals? And he said, I want to lose some weight and, you know, tone my body up. And I just said, bro, we're not the right gym for you. That's not what we do here. And he looked really confused, and he was like, oh, really? What do you do here? And I said, we teach people how to move. And he said, what does that mean? I said, well, people come to us to learn how to do handstands and muscle ups and the splits and, you know, to get stronger than they've ever been before and more flexible. And he went, oh, okay. But, you know, you're doing them a service and you're doing yourself a service by doing that, because there are better gyms for weight loss around the corner. There's, like, we don't even do much cardio in our program at all. So,
Well, and not that we don't agree with it. It's just that we don't prioritize it. Now, very quickly, I'll end on this because this is something that you certainly need to work towards. This is our North Star. This is just a document that I have laminated next to my workstation. And this has basically got our purpose. We teach people how to be healthy to make the world a better place. It has our values and it has our mission statement on here. Now, this is literally what we run our business from. It determines the culture, the direction of our culture. It determines how we represent ourselves in our business, how we communicate to you guys. It is everything. And that's something that took us really 16 years to define and get crystal clear on. Now, it's not just something for us. And Richard, can you switch to the other camera and just quickly point it out the door and show them? We've never done this before, but we're going to get Richie on a mobile camera. So I do apologize. Our gimbal wasn't fully charged, so it's going to be a little bit unstable. But Richie's going to take you outside our studio here into the gym and just show you that this is up on the wall. Like,
That's reception. So if you just, Richie, just film just quickly each one of the core values, just very quickly, just the headlines so they can see what they all are. And then just jump in front of the reception, Richard, so they can see where that's shown.
Oh, died.
Oh, there you go. Look at that.
We lost the phone.
We lost the feed. But our core values are to care about the community, take personal responsibility, pursue personal development, take massive action, and get results. And you can see them there. At least you saw them for a sec. I can see them coming up on the feed. But that's directly behind reception.
That's the first thing people see when they walk into our gym. It's also in our members area in the change room. Well, you got a quick snap of it before our feed died. But this is the thing, guys. Like, we are so crystal clear on this. And I have it next to me. We've got our mission and our vision, our company mission framed on the wall next to my workstation. We've got these laminated images up everywhere. It's just so ingrained into our culture here now, and that's what you got to do, man. To become a great coach, you got to be crystal clear on what it is you do, who you do it for, and why. And then start with the why. You know, for us, we believe the health and fitness industry is backward. You shouldn't be trying to reverse engineer a body. It produces shitty results, and it plays into the society's insecurities about how they look. Your health should be measured by how your body feels and performs, not by how it looks. Looking good is a side effect to moving good and feeling good, because you can have the healthiest looking, ripped, chiseled abs and amazing biceps and be as mentally messed up as the most crazy person in the world. looking good is certainly not a good reflection or indication of overall health. It is a byproduct of being healthy, not the other way around. And the majority of people who walk around out there looking amazing on the inside aren't always that healthy, man. And we want to change that. We're very, very, very passionate about changing the way people perceive health.
Yeah. Yeah, and you need to find, as Yanni said, what your North Star is. You need to be very clear on what it is that you're passionate about. And, you know, you don't need to know the answer of how you're going to become a good coach. But, like, I mean, in all honesty, the reason why the Foundation Movement System is what it is because Yanni and I were both so different 10 years ago. And we didn't agree on what we do at all. We really didn't. Yanni, when I got out of the army, Yanni was really into the idea of training people by the science of what the science says is the best way to train people for fat loss or muscle hypertrophy or strength, and that was it. And that didn't resonate with me. And what I wanted was to train people for something that felt good and made you feel like you wanted to do it. That was really important to me. And through that difference, we came to this balance because I pulled Yanni away from this scientific approach to training and brought it towards something that's more fun and more of a pursuit of skill. And Yanni pulled me more towards something that had some grounded evidence in it. And this is the better way to train because there's good research to show it rather than some airy-fairy thing that I probably would have created if it wasn't for Yanni. But through that, you know, through Yanni having his vision and me having my vision, we found something that we came together
and to create. And Richard. Pulling us back from the clouds every once in a while and slapping Richard some sense into us.
And we came to something that we all really agree on is the better way to train. And that's what you got to do.
Yeah, absolutely.
But that's it, man. That's all we got time for, Yanni.
We're out of time. Great question, though, and a different direction. It was nice to talk about something a little bit different and something that we're actually experts in.
Yeah.
Unlike nutrition.
Yeah.
Keep those questions coming, guys. It's really, really, it's great. And again, welcome to all the new people. We hope to see you soon on the inside of the Movement Mastermind, posting up epic videos of your progress. And we will see you all tomorrow to wrap up the week with a huge show. Again, guys, the link is in the description. You are not going to get a better opportunity to trial what it's like to work with us. $75 US for $744 worth of value. It's honestly, jump on board the other hundreds of people who have done so over the last 24 hours and get into it. See you soon. We are the gym that teaches people how to move instead of just exercise because we believe that health is about performance, not just body image.